Hello, it's Scott Miley here, taking another look at Kerbal Space Program 0.90. Now, if you've been looking at my hints and guides for beginners, you'll know that I am a big fan of stage recovery, recovering stages for extra cash to help you in the early game with upgrading those buildings. Well, there's a couple of mods I want to talk about to help you with this. The first is stage recovery, and you can see this is active down here with this icon here. I click on it, and a message appears in my inbox, which tells me that with the current fuel values, the stage will be destroyed. However, when it's empty, the terminal velocity will be 6.6 and I will recover 99% of it. So what that's saying is this middle stage here with the liquid fuel and the liquid engine, all those expensive parts, those have parachutes to stop it and stage recovery will recover it for me. Okay, so let's get this show on the road, firing up that main solid rocket booster, throttling up the main engines in preparation for their firing. This is, of course, running with a Stay Putnik probe. I'm still early in the tech tree. That's where I think the real game is right now for newbies. This means it does not have SAS for manual automatic stability control. Therefore, I have to fly it manually. Just like the good old days. Wait for things to burn out and immediately switch over. Okay, so that stage is going to fall back towards the ground. And I can click on the stage recovery window here. So this is the stage recovery mod. There was another mod called Debris Fund, which was supported for a while, but it doesn't look like it's being updated. So stage recovery appears to be the way to go. Yeah, that stage has not shown. Ah, there we go. Destroyed stages, moon probe debris. That would be the stage which dropped to the planet. It was a stack decoupler and a solid rocket booster. I lost 465 funds because I did not have any respect for it. I could have put a bit of parachute on it, and I'm not sure it would have been worth it. It's a relatively small amount of cash. You know, if you add extra mass to that, then of course it means less fuel and stuff on the rest of the rocket. So you have to weigh these decisions whenever you're trying to design a rocket. Obviously, unlike real rockets, we're not having to deal with the problem of cleaning salt water out of engines and things like that, which is quite expensive given the fantastically high tolerances required of rocket engines and things like that. You really don't want to have foreign objects and foreign substances inside your fuel lines and things like that. But yeah, we're not dealing with that. So yeah, we're getting up to speed. Let me see, we're on to our last tank. Now, normally we would have to fly this on a much steeper trajectory because we would have to make sure that we got above the magic 20 kilometer mark with sufficient vertical velocity that we could get our spacecraft boosted up to its insertion velocity before the main stage fell back. And that did mean that we weren't flying things perfectly as efficiently as we would like. So yeah, we're going to ditch this now, and off it goes, and the main engine now fires on this. This is a lot more squirrely. There it is, falling away on its parachutes. Now, that will continue, because it will continue beyond 2.5 kilometers. The magic limit, I believe, for removing objects from the game is below 20 kilometers, objects below 2.5 or above 2.5 kilometers away are removed and therefore considered destroyed. What the stage recovery mod does is if it sees something in this situation, it will then figure out if it has enough parachutes to successfully soft land on Kerbin. Kerbin's obviously the one you're interested on. If you have something that soft lands on Duna, I don't think it even cares. But yeah, here we go. So yeah, that actually might be something for future versions, who knows. This might be going a little flatter than I would like. The orbit is perhaps a little flatter, but it shouldn't matter too much. Let's see if we got stage recovery yet on this. We should go to the map, actually, so we can see this thing getting removed from existence there. Let's mouse over it. You see how it's falling down? And as it gets below 20 kilometers, I guess it wasn't even 20 kilometers. It's been removed from existence, but hopefully it has been recovered. There we go. We get a successful recovery. We recovered 5,000 funds from making sure that we had the right kind of parachutes on that thing. So yeah, that works with the rockets that I've got. However, it needs parachutes, right? It's not going to work with things like SpaceX's attempts to soft land a rocket on a barge using rockets rather than parachutes. It's not going to work for things like Spaceship Two, where you have a carrier aircraft that flies up to altitude and then launches a smaller spacecraft which actually flies up and performs the mission into space. So if you want to do that, there is another mod which will help you out with that. So yes, if you want to land anything using a process more complicated than parachutes, then one of the things I could suggest is the Flight Manager for Reusable Stages mod by Sit89. So this will work if you want to land a spacecraft, or if you want to land a space plane perhaps, that's a carrier plane, if you want to land something on rockets, or perhaps you want to land something on a combination of parachutes and rockets, because parachutes actually work very well for helping keep things stable. So this is a Pegasus-style launcher. We have a plane which has just turbojets on it, and in the payload bay, we have a space probe that has some problems launching, but once we get this going, it will be marvelous. Okay, come on. Point in the right direction and light up that candle. There we go. So this is a very cheap system, obviously. It's just a solid rocket booster with a very small space probe on top. The space probe has enough fuel for orbital insertion and maybe a whole lot more, we don't really know. But the bulk of the mass is coming from that large single-use solid rocket motor. Now you see we've already gone off beyond the range and that spacecraft has actually disappeared. However, on the left here you see FMRS 0301, the window. We see that stage 3 separated at 2 minutes and 51 seconds, and there's a button for the air launch ship. So we're going to go back to that once we've got this thing into orbit. We just need to let this thing, you know, carve its way through the lower atmosphere. It's going pretty fast, but I think it will get up into orbit without me having to light up the liquid-fueled engine. There we go there. And it's actually pretty stable now that we've let everything calm down, now that the forces of the atmosphere are no longer acting on those little fins there. The main problem with designing this is putting those fins inside the cargo bay in such a way that they give control, but they don't cause the spacecraft to be supremely overpowered in terms of reaction wheels. So there we go, waiting. 73 kilometers, we are now above the magic of time acceleration. So normally going up to this altitude, it would take far too long, and that whatever stage I had used would have fallen back to the surface. So, but instead, it's still being kept in cryogenic suspension with the Flight Manager. Now the Flight Manager, what it's done is it has created save states. It's created a bunch of automatic save states for me. If you use software version control, it's very similar. It's creating like a fork of the save file, which you will then be able to work on and then ultimately merge the changes back into your main. Maybe that's a little obtuse for people that aren't into programming, but it makes complete sense to me. So there, we get our stuff circularized. Just get this nice and circular. Great! So we have a spacecraft in orbit. Now to deal with the landing, we have to... So we're 17 minutes into the mission now, and we're going to jump back to about 3 minutes into the mission. So here we go, click on this, and it thinks for a second as it reloads, and there we go! Now we're flying things as it once was. The space probe is obviously removed from the vicinity. Since time travel is involved, please don't build a space probe that then flies back and kills the main space plane, because that would just lead to weird causality violations. I'm going to try and turn this around and send it back to the Kerbal Space Center. And the fastest way to do this is to actually dive down. So I'm deliberately pointing the nose downwards, and I'm going to do an inverted loop here. The idea being that we're pulling ourselves deep into the atmosphere, and the deeper you go into the atmosphere, the harder you're going to turn. So I just don't want to have to end up going a really, really long way away from the Space Center, because I'm having to fly this back manually. Interesting question. I guess mission time says we're about 3 minutes and 40 seconds into the mission, and we know that the space probe achieves a stable orbit at around 17 minutes. I wonder whether I'll be able to get it back to the landing site inside the 17 minutes. Obviously, I'm going to put this in accelerated time to make sure that everything happens a little more quickly. This is all running 4 times regular speed, so just because it makes the whole thing a little more watchable. So I do actually gain a little bit of altitude on the way back, and I use some debris that's sitting near the space center as kind of my guide for altitude. When you're trying to land a spacecraft, it's good to follow a kind of more or less flat, steady descent profile. So what I try to do is keep my velocity vector pointed just roughly where the target is, although you see that the target is slightly off to the left. So I'm really just using the velocity vector as an attitude control. Also, make sure you're in surface mode, otherwise you will be subtracting the velocity of rotation of the planet, which is about 175 meters per second, and that can lead to some very strange and frustrating and scary numbers when you realize that you thought you were traveling at 100 meters per second, but in fact you're traveling at zero, and you're stalling out of the sky. Yes, I have done that before. There aren't actually real satellite launchers that work this way. The Pegasus by Orbital Sciences, it's made something like 40 launches, I believe, and it's been pretty reliable. It uses solid rocket boosters, again, for super cheapness. The carrier aircraft on that, incidentally, is called the Stargazer, and there's some people that think this is deliberate because William Riker served aboard the Pegasus and Jean-Luc Picard served aboard the Stargazer. Coincidence or magic? Who cares? Anyway, this thing is actually surprisingly difficult to land because it has no air brakes. We really need some stock air brakes in the game, guys. So I'm flying down at about 64 meters per second, and it barely wants to touch the runway. It has to go at such a low or high angle of attack to get the rear wheels down that that then makes it lift back off the runway. So, yeah, on the ground, activate the brakes. Actually, this is going to be pretty good. We're just going to park it next to the runway here, next to these highly explosive fuel tanks. That's exactly where you want to put a space plane, right? Next to the expensive fuel that could explode and kill everyone. So now we've stopped. We can recover the vessel. And magic, magic, magic. It should go to the recovery screen. And I think this is not actually in career mode. So it just shows that we've recovered the crew. But if you're in career mode, it will recover the cash and the science. Possibly, the science may not recover correctly from return stages, I have heard, but that may have been fixed by now. Should check that out. And the game automatically returns control of the satellite. I'm Scott Manley. Fly safe.